Hi, I'm Michael Janich, and welcome to the Martial Blade Concepts video series. Martial Blade Concepts, or MBC, is a system of personal defense that I developed that focuses on the use of edge weapons. It's drawn from the critical elements and fundamental principles of the Filipino martial arts, elements of the Indonesian martial arts, and other edge weapon systems, but it really focuses on modern self-defense. Now, if you're familiar with any of the other materials I've done on edge weapon tactics, specifically the Fighting Folder series, to put it simply, this video series is designed to make that series obsolete. It's not that the information in that series is bad, it's just that it represents what is now an outdated training methodology. By presenting the information in the current system so that you're learning applications first and then reinforcing that with the training drills, I find you're going to be able to learn better, you're going to be able to retain the information a whole lot better, and you're going to achieve a higher skill level in a much shorter period of time. So with all that stuff said, let's go ahead and jump into the training. In addition to the critical skills that we introduced in Volume 1 of the MBC series, we also introduced a drill called Hubud. Let's review that real quickly and show you how we happen to do Hubud. Vince chops down this way with an angle 1, basically coming in from the outside with my left hand, slapping that aside, wedging upward with my right hand, then my left hand comes around, checks his arm down. At this point, I've got a clean shot at him. He does the same thing. Left, right, left, left, right, left. The real operative part of this is this wedging action right here. This is what's really going to save you, because that is the structure. This is the speed, this is the structure that you want. We don't like blocking this way with the initial hand. If Vince is striking down and I block here, he's smart enough to simply yank that out of the way and go to work. It's not going to do me much good. If you've seen the Counterblade Concepts video or seen any of the Counterblade Concepts material that I've shared before, the passing drill is something that we do quite a bit in there. This is also something you'll find in other Filipino martial arts. You may be familiar with it from other sources. The main thing you want to do on this, once I achieve this index, I'm using the back of my arm. So technically, Eric is on the outside of my arm. Even if he's trying to touch my gut, I can keep him on the outside of my body simply by turning my body through and using the strength of this structure to move that arm across. What this gives us is not only a backup for angle 2, but it starts to introduce this idea of going crossbody and passing it across, and that's something that we can do with either hand, whether we have a weapon or not. Okay, so let's take a look first of all at how we can finish up the application of this passing line and achieve something that we call underarm control. If he throws angle 2, I cut and check here. Now as I pass this through, what I'm going to do is I'm going to collect the elbow from the back. So let's go ahead and do-si-do and show this a little bit clearer from this side. So he throws angle 2, I cut and check. As I pass this through, I'm bringing my hand, my palm, straight to my chest. Okay, so what I want to do is bring this in tight. That's going to give me that control. If I were doing an empty hand passing drill, I would have my other hand ready to go. So if we were here, this hand would be up just in case he decided to climb up this arm and get frisky and try to get me again so I could pass it back in the other direction. By using the same common technique as far as the application, same common mechanics with the empty hand, we're here, I pass this through, this hand is up and high, I still have that capability if I need it. But as I suck this in, what I also want to look at is the ability to pressure cut. One of the things we believe in very strongly in MBC is looking at the actual threats that are out there on the street. We analyze video whenever possible of actual violent attacks and try to figure out how our skills match up. This is unlike a lot of traditional martial arts where they say, well, you need to attack me this way so I can do this technique. Everything that we do is designed to deal with reality the best way that we know how. Now, when you look at the MBC system, especially everything you've seen thus far, we're focused on a right-hand bias. And that's the way MBC is built. That's the way most Filipino martial arts are built. They assume that you're right-handed. And that's 90+% of the people out there. When you look at the attacks that typically happen on the street, they're going to be gross motor skill attacks primarily from a right-handed attacker. Statistically, that is what's going to happen most. But that doesn't mean that lefties don't exist. It doesn't mean that lefty attackers don't exist. One of the sayings we have at MBC is to have a plan and work your plan. So let's go back to the things we know best, the master technique of MBC, the first thing we learn. So Vince is attacking me right-handed. He attacks. I cut basically with an angle 1. There's the pass. Now I'm going to cut his tricep with either a 2 or a 4. Given his height, let's call it a 2. I step in, I check, and now I'm going to finish with that mobility cut going for the angle 3. So my motions are basically 1, 2, 3. If I take that plan and now I apply it against a left-handed attack, this is the way a lefty is going to attack me. It's going to be a forehand shot coming in this way. So what I'm going to do is use the same pattern of motion, but apply it against this attack. So when Vince attacks, I'm getting out of the way, cutting the back of his hand. So essentially I'm using a follow. What was against the right hand, a pass, against the left is a follow, but it's the exact same motion as far as I'm concerned. Again, he attacks, I cut my next shot, angle two still takes that tricep, but now my check, instead of driving 30 degrees that way, I'm checking with this hand, driving 30 degrees that way instead. That's what's going to keep him from coming back at me. And again, what I'm achieving is the same principle, a strut that is allowing me to use body structure and skeletal structure to keep him back. Now, once I finish this cut here, I don't have a quadricep to play with. So we're back to the idea of using peripheral nerves for stopping power. If you think about the sciatic nerve, it basically comes out of the butt, comes down this way, and it tells a lot of that leg what to do. People will talk about hamstringing people, cutting the biceps femoris here, the hamstring muscle. That is not going to take Vince out of the fight. It's basically going to cause him to have foot drop. He won't be able to bend his knee. But what will really significantly disable him is cutting that sciatic nerve. One of the things, if you've seen our practical unarmed combative series, anytime that we're dealing with either a punch or a knife attack, doesn't matter, one of the basic techniques we teach is what we call a shoulder stop. When you look at the instinct of people, if you get up on YouTube and take a look at street fights, a lot of times you'll see people doing this kind of thing instinctively, trying to hold people back, hoping their arms are longer than the other guy so they don't get hit. Well, that instinct of driving your arms out is very similar to what we would do with de cuerdas. When it comes to the empty hand application and angle one or something comes in, we would simply suck this in tight and now we'd go to work with all of our hits. When we put this back into context with the knife, let's go ahead and do-si-do again, please. When we put this into context with the knife, as a spontaneous reaction, what we get is what we call punch and cut. I'm still going to be checking with this hand, I'm still going to be extending with this hand, but what I'm going to do is use the fist that is below the knife as the stop for that shoulder stop. So the angle one comes in, bang, I'm basically hitting here. Now as I suck this in, I reach over the top, suck this under my armpit to achieve that control. This also helps roll the juicy part of the arm out. I pressure cut that and I work the quad. So again, the attack comes in, stop it, suck it in as I pressure cut, and I work the leg. At this point in the instruction, what we're going to start doing is looking at some of the drills that we use in the MBC system. We've gotten a good feel for combative application and the basic skills that we need. The drills that we use are designed to isolate specific techniques and be able to refine those techniques, at least those initial movements. So one of the first ones we're going to look at is what's called the largo mano drill. The next drill we're going to look at is really kind of the core of our standard grip drills when it comes to MBC, and it's called the sombrada drill. The next drill we're going to look at is one that I actually picked up from Lightning Scientific Arnis as a stick drill. It's called the speed drill. I adapted that to MBC knife to kind of fill in some of the blanks as far as what I considered vulnerabilities based on the other drills we practiced. MBC has a number of different training drills, as you've seen already in this series. Each of those drills was chosen or created for the MBC system to be able to isolate and refine a specific skill. Once you've mastered that drill, once you've refined that particular skill, the idea is to put them all together in what we call the chess game. And the chess game is basically a training methodology that allows us to flow from one drill to another, to take selected components out of one drill and plug them into another one, and to do so spontaneously. I'm doing it to challenge my partner, he does it to challenge me, and what we end up with is a good controlled framework where nobody's getting hurt, but at the same time, it's very spontaneous, very unpredictable, and that's what promotes reflex. Excellent. Totally spontaneous, high speed, challenging each other. I'm not telling Eric what I'm doing. He's not telling me what he's doing. You get to rock, and you have to flow with it. You develop it to the point where your reactions are that spontaneous, you're going to have good skills to use on the street.